This video may not be for everyone. If you are already fluent in economics, or if you are not interested in economics at all, you can just keep scrolling. But if you are one of those who already know a little, but still feel foggy about everything you learned, this may help you clear it up. So based on the comments on these last few videos I made earlier, I noticed that a lot of people still don't really understand what demand and supply curves mean. And that can be a problem because the entire system of economics depends on those two curves. Interest rates, exchange rates, wages, inflation, everything starts from those curves, demand and supply. But most videos out there seem to assume that everyone already took calculus and knows the basics. So I'm here to help those of you who never took calculus to understand those curves. Let's first start from a completely unrelated example. So let's say someone is designing a tunnel and they try to figure out how high the tunnel should be. So the vertical axis is the height of the tunnel. And the horizontal axis is the number of cars that can fit in the tunnel. So how do we draw the curve? So we line up all the cars based on how high their roofs are, from the lowest to the highest. For simplicity, let's say this place only has 7 cars. Okay, so the lowest car is this high, and the second lowest car this high, and all the way to the highest. So if we connect the top of these bars, we get a curve. That curve exactly portrays the relationship between the height of the tunnel and the number of cars that can fit in. When the tunnel is this high, only 1 car can pass. When the tunnel is this high, 2 cars can pass. And when the tunnel is this high, all the 7 cars can pass. So the curve is going up, obviously, because the higher the tunnel, the more cars will be able to go through it. Now let's change up the variables. Let this be the price of product, and let this be the quantity of the product that will be produced. So instead of lining up the cars, we line up all the units of this product based on how much it costs to produce them, from the lowest to the highest. Obviously, not every unit costs the same. Some producers may be more efficient, and some producers may have better access to materials, some producers may have access to cheap labor. So the production cost of each unit is different. Let's just rank them from the least costly unit to the most costly unit. So if the price is this high, then only 2 units will be produced. But if the price is this high, that means 5 units will be produced. Because if your production cost is higher than the market price, you won't be able to make it without losing money. So the market price is like the tunnel, and your cost is like the height of your car. So your cost has to be low enough for your product to pass the market constraint. So when you connect the top of these bars, you get a curve that represents the relationship between the price and the number of units the producers would like to supply. So that's the supply curve. Now let's think about what's the total amount of money the producers will earn under a certain price. This unit will earn the producer a lot of money because it was produced with a very low cost. This unit, not so much. This is your profit, right? The distance between your production cost and the market price. So the total amount of money earned by all the producers, which is called the producer's surplus, is the sum of all these individual profits. But in reality, we don't have just 7 units, right? For any product, we're talking about maybe 7,000 or 7 million or even more. So these bars will be squeezed together really tight, like this. That means when we add up all the producer's profit, we're really calculating the area of this shape. And all the bars are squeezed into a shape. So this is actually the basic idea of calculus. Right? Sometimes we want to find the area of an irregular shape. What do? We add up all the bars in that shape, and we make the width of each bar approach zero. The narrower the bars, the closer it is for the sum of them to approach the area of the shape. That's really what calculus is about. Well, at least at the entry level. So yeah, when we have a lot of producers and a large quantity of the product, the area of this shape is really the producer surplus. And the demand curve is sort of the opposite. So instead of a tunnel, let's imagine the top shelf of a store. So the lower it is, the more people will be able to reach it. So let's line up all the customers by the height they can reach, from the tallest to the shortest. So when the shelf is this high, only one customer can reach it. And when the shelf is this high, about four customers, 405, can reach it. So obviously the curve is going down because the lower the shelf, the more customers can reach it. Now let's change up the variables. Let's make the vertical axis the price of a product. Okay, and then we change the horizontal axis to the number of units that will be sold. So instead of lining up customers based on their heights, we line them up based on how much they're willing to pay for that product. Of course, different people have different evaluation of a product. It can depend on how much you love that product, or how much your life requires it, or how rich you are. But let's forget about the underlying reasons. We just need to know each customer assign a different value to that product. So we line them up from high to low. When the price is this high, only the first customer will buy it. And when the price is this high, two people will buy it. And when the price is this high, all these five people will buy it. So this is called a demand curve, and obviously it's going down. So what's the total satisfaction these customers derive from this product? It's the price they're willing to pay minus the market price. If I'm willing to pay $8 for this sandwich, and I notice that the price is $5, that means I gained $3 of surplus from this transaction. Because I spent $5 on something I would happily buy for $8. So the total consumer surplus is the sum of these bars above the actual price. Again, if we have thousands or even millions of customers, these bars will be close together, and the area of this shape, this red shape, will be the entire consumer surplus. Okay, now you know what the demand and supply curves mean and how to represent consumer and producer surpluses. So you can start to understand a lot of more complicated models in economics. Now, if you go back to these last few videos I posted on the topic, they will be a piece of cake for you. And remember, I provide online tutoring on a lot of topics, especially math and social sciences. So hit me up.